Cuba, our closest foreign adversary that sparked a nuclear missile crisis with Russia last century, is suspect in a new dangerous liaison.
There is a lot about China and concerns and allegations that China has already been operating some sort of base or surveillance operation out of Cuba and plans to have some sort of larger operation out of Cuba. Is that true?
And that has been repeated. No evidence has been put in place.
I mean, no evidence, but is it true?
This week, we report from the communist island nation that still seems to play an outsized role in American foreign policy. The rising voice of hatred.
What on earth is behind the rise in anti-Semitic sentiment on college campuses?
It's heartbreaking. There's no question about it. That is full force anti-Semitism.
We examine the rise in anti-Semitism and what our own government is doing to control it.
And when you want to go after terrorists, follow the money.
This is a worldwide global operation, unquestionably worth billions and billions of dollars.
Welcome to Full Measure. I'm Sharyl Attkisson. The Middle East is the focus of American and international concerns with a war that's threatening to expand, but the U.S. has to simultaneously keep eyes wide open on a number of fronts. That includes our closest adversary by proximity, Cuba. As the U.S. continues to enforce a longstanding embargo against the communist nation, the U.N. General Assembly recently voted to condemn the restrictions. Meantime, cut off from the U.S., Cuba is strengthening ties with another nemesis, China. Our laws forbid Americans from visiting the island as tourists, and journalists require a visa from Cuba. We finally got approved for one after several years of trying. So today from Havana, we examine the rocky U.S.-Cuba relationship and how that impacts where Cuba finds its support. An hour-long flight from Miami to Havana on a near-empty plane delivers us to the beautiful but impoverished Caribbean island of Cuba. One of America's closest foreign neighbors, yet mostly cut off from the U.S. Partly frozen in time, people stand in line to collect their government food rations of bread, milk, and eggs. Classic cars from the 50s populate the roads. Under the U.S. embargo, newer cars, even necessities, are expensive and difficult to get.
There aren't many images of Fidel Castro around Havana anymore. He died 7 years ago. His brother, Raul, who succeeded him, stepped down as Cuba's leader in 2021, officially ending 62 years of Castro rule. The 2.5 years since have been marked by ongoing challenges, historic changes, and new appeals to the U.S. How do you suspect Cuba would look today if not for the embargo?
That's what we would like to see.
Carlos Fernandez de Cosillo is Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs and Cuba's chief spokesman for our government-approved visit.
Anyone who would visit a country would know that we live a very modest life, that our infrastructure needs a lot of investment in it, that we have lots of problems with our economy. What I would put to a test, allow the U.S. to lift the embargo for just 2 years, and measure what Cuba can be done.
Sugar is king.
It was in the 1950s that the U.S. began cutting back on buying Cuba's number one export, sugar.
It is the heart of the island's economic life.
In 1959, revolutionaries ousted the U.S.-supported Cuban dictator. His replacement, Fidel Castro, cozied up to the Soviet Union and closed a deal to trade Cuban sugar for Soviet oil. In 1960, Castro seized American sugar factories and Esso, Texaco, and Shell refineries that refused to process Soviet oil. In 1961, the U.S. supported the Bay of Pigs military invasion to overthrow Castro. It failed. In 1962, the U.S. banned most trade with Cuba. A growing Soviet weapons buildup on the island led to a confrontation with America called the Cuban Missile Crisis. Obama eased restrictions on Cuba. Trump retightened the clamp and even listed Cuba as a state sponsor of terrorism. And Biden has continued down the Trump path. Fernandez de Cosio terms it economic warfare.
What do you suspect are the true reasons the United States has the policies that it does?
An aim to control the fate and the destination of Cuba. And as I said at the beginning, the failure to recognize that we have the right to have our own government in the way we feel and to carry out a system of economy and policy which ensures social justice, which we call socialism. We don't do it against the United States. We do it for the benefit of the people of Cuba.
With the U.S. relationship strained for so long, it's hard to overlook U.S. adversaries making new plays. In July, the first official visit by a Russian naval vessel in years. The two countries have forged deals to let Russia bring in more tourists, develop hotels, and supply Cuba with lots of oil. China's influence is as evident as the thousands of China-made buses on Cuba's streets.
Do you see any merit to the argument that in the United States there may be concern with Cuba so very close to our shores that Cuba has close relationships with countries that are considered adversaries, such as Russia and China?
There's no evidence to prove that. The U.S. government, the people in the government have raised it, but there's no evidence of any hostile or offensive activity by either Russia, China, or any country that the United States would think is an adversary against the United States. The United States would have it. They would have taken action on it. It hasn't occurred. But it serves as an excuse for those that do not want any progress in the bilateral relationship.
China has really made a lot of inroads in many countries where the United States has perhaps stepped back economically. Is that happening in Cuba as well?
It's happening perhaps in a lesser level than other countries in Latin America, but it's a good relationship. Most of our relationship is trade. We buy a lot of products for our industry in China. If we could, we would buy them in the United States. It's much closer and perhaps cheaper, but the U.S. laws prohibit it. We have to buy a lot in China. They give us financing, and they have invested in some infrastructure, for example, in an important plant for edition, for news edition and printing, in the rail, in some industries. But it's a normal relationship, as we've had with Canada, as we've had with European countries, as we would have it with the United States if it were to be possible.
U.S. officials have raised serious concerns amid reports of Chinese spy operations out of Cuba, just 90 miles from Key West, Florida.
This is something we're going to be monitoring very, very closely, and we've been very clear about that. And we will protect our homeland. We will protect our interests.
In the news in the United States, there is a lot about China and concerns and allegations that China has already been operating some sort of base or surveillance operation out of Cuba and plans to have some sort of larger operation out of Cuba. Is that true?
That came out in a story that was published by the Wall Street Journal and then has been repeated. No evidence has been put in place.
I mean, no evidence, but is it true?
It is totally untrue. We've told the U.S. government. We've spoken with them. We said more. We said that Cuba is a country under aggression from the United States, that we have the right to defend ourselves, that we have the right to establish defense cooperation with other governments, and we don't have to give excuses for that. Now, that being understood, what has been proclaimed, and then it's totally untrue. It's a fabrication, again, as others that have happened, the many that have happened in history, to try to make it impossible for there to be progress in the relationship between our two governments.
That's Cuba's side of the story.
So the regime, of course, Cosío and everyone from the regime in Cuba is lying.
Another side more often heard in the U.S. is expressed by Cubans like Siley Gonzalez, a former business owner now living in Miami, Florida.
The situation of human rights in Cuba has been always bad, but right now it's massively bad, okay?
She and others point to government arrests after mass protests on July 11th, 2021.
Cuba is a dictatorship, and they are owning and being in the power in Cuba as the dictators that they are. That means that they are just there because they want to keep the power. They own the island. They create business for themselves. They create institutions for themselves, for protecting themselves.
Democrats and Republicans alike have joined to criticize Cuba on a number of fronts, including alleged human rights abuses. One example they give is the July 11th protests. They say there are still many people imprisoned unjustifiably.
It is difficult to gauge how many people went out on the street to protest that day. Some say 15, 20, let's say 25,000. Most of them did it peacefully. A small group, maybe about 1,000, practicing vandalism, violence, inciting violence, attacking police stations, burning cars. Those were prosecuted. Most of them went to jail. Of those, perhaps about half have already been released. But in the US, on January 6th, many people went to protest in the United States. I would suspect the great majority of them peacefully. They were protesting the government. And many have been prosecuted. Some have been sent to jail. Some with sentences as large as 18 years without any violence or critical violence being committed. So why does the United States feel it has the authority to condemn Cuba and not look inside what is happening in the United States?
The State Department declined our request for an on-camera interview. Lawrence Gumbiner was a senior U.S. diplomat in Cuba. We asked him a question that Cuba's Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs asked us. Why is it fair that the U.S. does lots of business with other communist states like China and Vietnam, but shuns Cuba?
I don't think you can state it's fair. I don't think there's a rationale that can distinguish that activity. It's the same. A U.S. citizen can travel to North Korea with less restrictions than it can travel to Cuba. The foreign policy establishment and the U.S. Congress is very hard to agree to loosen or release the embargo right now. And for most presidents and most secretaries of state, the upside of opening up is not matched by the perceived downside risk for the in terms of their domestic political standing.
Americans will hear you say one thing and the United States government say something else. What are they to make of the two entirely different pictures being portrayed?
They would have to look at it for themselves. Cubans are not prohibited to travel to the U.S. Americans are prohibited to travel to Cuba. Americans should ask their government to allow them to freely travel to Cuba and allow them for themselves to judge reality, not to have to ask for permission to see if it's granted, or run the risk of being punished for exercising the wish to visit another country and learn by themselves.
A new analysis of the Cuba-China relationship concludes the two countries are likely to increase their political and economic cooperation in the next 12 months, but that it's unlikely China will open new surveillance bases there. When we return, addressing Jewish hate on college campuses. Since the Islamic extremist terrorist group Hamas attacked Israel on October 7th, there's been an alarming spike in Jewish hate crimes here in the U.S., much of it occurring on American college campuses. The White House recently issued a call to action to try to address it. The White House recently announced the first ever U.S. national strategy to counter Islamophobia, but it was already implementing a similar effort set up a few months earlier to fight anti-Semitism. The White House met weekly with Jewish leaders and, along with two dozen agencies, devised 100 calls to action now being implemented. That includes letters going out to America's educational institutions. Shelley Greenspan is White House Jewish liaison.
The Department of Education is making it clear that under Title VI, the Civil Rights Acts, that both anti-Semitism and Islamophobia are covered under Title VI reforms. So they're working on Dear Colleague letters to make that clear to colleges, universities, K-12 schools, and they're also making it easier for students or anyone really to file a complaint under Title VI.
What does Title VI say?
beforehand, many were using Title VI, the Civil Rights Act, to include some form of anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, or characteristics based on shared ancestry, but it was never made explicitly clear in writing. So what we did is had, I think, six agencies make it clear in writing that you are entitled to file a complaint under Title VI if you have experienced discrimination or harassment based on your shared ancestry.
You mentioned college campuses, most of which get some federal money. What on earth is behind the rise in anti-Semitic sentiment on college campuses? And should we have been doing something much sooner to try to attack this?
It's heartbreaking what we're seeing right now on college campuses. Students right now are barricading themselves inside buildings. They are having to endure protests where, you know, the annihilation for Israel and a genocide for Jews is being called out just on, you know, in the quad space. And it's anti-Semitism. There's no question about it. That is full force anti-Semitism. We are working very closely with the Department of Education right now. They've been doing a handful of site visits to some of the campuses where we've seen really an uptick in these anti-Semitic incidences to really get to the source of the problem. We're providing students with resources, whether it's filing a complaint or trying to figure out how they can best utilize resources within their campus environment. But it's a really scary time to be a college student right now. And we want students to know that we have their back and we're doing everything possible within our government tools to make sure that campus remains a safe environment.
Do you think anti-Semitism at some of these colleges is part of an information campaign? It's hard to imagine that this just organically came from generations of students that passed through on their own. Is it somehow organized?
I'm not sure if it's organized per se. I will say, you know, just looking at the statistics that came out of the hate crimes report, you know, a month ago, and these were statistics from 2021 to 2022, there was a 35% increase in anti-Semitic incidences. And for the Jewish community, a population that represents only 2.4% of the population, the majority of religious-based hate crimes were anti-Semitic, which I think speaks to just the terrible reality of this problem. This is nothing new. We're just seeing such a dramatic and scary spike in it right now. But this is a problem that's been going on for a while, and that's why we've developed all these different resources and tools, and we're aggressively implementing this national strategy. But it's a whole of society effort.
Is it difficult for the president to find sort of a balance when he is clearly being tugged by some members of his own party? Not that he agrees with anti-Semitic sentiment being put out by other Democrats, but that is happening in, among members of Congress and just among some at large. How does he grapple with that?
The only thing giving me hope right now is President Biden's moral clarity and his support for Israel, and also just the resiliency of the Jewish community. So while there might be disagreements and he's getting tugged, as you mentioned, in multiple directions, his moral clarity has been steadfast, I think, from the day he took office. So I have full confidence that he'll continue on this route.
The Biden Justice Department and Homeland Security Agency are said to be partnering with college law enforcement to track what they're calling hate-related threats. When we come back, an underground world of terrorist financing. The ground war between Israel and both Hamas and Hezbollah has raised questions about the underground world of money and financing that's behind decades of terrorism. In the year leading up to the attacks, both groups received large amounts of funding through crypto. But as Scott Thuman reports, there's a longstanding network that works like a multinational criminal enterprise.
As the Israeli army fights inside Gaza, a clearer picture is emerging about Hamas, a terror group that launched the deadly October 7th attack. Founded in 1987, Hamas is made up of Islamist extremists committed to the destruction of Israel and designated a terrorist organization by the U.S. in 1997. While its armed fighters conduct attacks, the Hamas political wing runs Gaza, and a big fundraising network brings in cash. John Hanna, a former national security advisor for then Vice President Dick Cheney, says some of that money comes from America.
Oh, there's no question. There have been serious FBI investigations and court cases brought against American front organizations for Hamas, who were engaged in all kinds of illegal fundraising to support what was out and out a terrorist group, according to the United States government.
In 2008, a U.S.-based Palestinian charity called the Holy Land Foundation and five individuals were found guilty of providing at least $12 million to support Hamas. Since then, the group has continued to use charities as fronts. And donations tend to rise whenever Israel takes military action, according to Dr. Matthew Levitt, an expert on terror financing at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy.
Most of them are not going to put up on their website, hey, we're Hamas, we're Islamic Jihad, give us money. They're going to show horrific, painful pictures of a dead Palestinian child, the kind of picture that will make you and me, all of us, feel sad and want to do something to help, but that money is going to be diverted.
One of the biggest and most reliable sources of money for Hamas and another Islamist armed terror group, Hezbollah, that's been attacking Israel from the north, is Iran.
Hezbollah gets, the U.S. government says, between $700 million and $1 billion, with a B, a year from Iran.
But Hezbollah also functions like a multinational corporation with a global network of operations. We went to see one such network for ourselves 5 years ago in South America. Situated next to Brazil and Argentina, South America's two biggest economies, the tri-border area has become a shopper's dream. But cloaked in that commerce may be terrorism. Luis Rojas was head of the country's drug enforcement team for years. He helped track the flow of money to Hezbollah.
Acá es una fachada.
Its face here may be political, but it's actually a strong terrorist organization. And the tri-border area is probably, possibly, its second largest global base in terms of logistics and financing.
With a benefactor as rich as Iran and financial networks that have been developed over decades, including everything from charity to drug running, cutting off the supply of money to groups like Hezbollah and Hamas is a long-term challenge. For Full Measure, I'm Scott Thuman in Washington.
After a break, what's ahead next week on Full Measure? Coming up this week on Full Measure, our investigation into the many debilitating illnesses emerging after both COVID and COVID vaccines. We meet a pioneering doctor whose team is treating hundreds of patients who couldn't find help elsewhere, what his new research can teach us and other doctors next week on Full Measure. Until next time, we'll be searching for more stories that hold powers accountable. Thanks for watching. I'm Sharyl Attkisson.